Blackstone Audio presents Scent of the Missing, Love and Partnership with a Search and Rescue Dog by Susannah Charleson. For Ellen Sanchez, who always believed and brought 1,000 cups of tea to prove it. For Puzzle, good dog, find more. Author's note, Scent of the Missing is a memoir of my experiences as a field assistant and young search and rescue canine handler. Unless otherwise attributed, the perspectives and opinions expressed here are my own and do not necessarily reflect those of teammates and colleagues in the field. Though this book is a nonfiction account of working search and rescue, compassion for the affected families and respect for their privacy have directed me to change names, locations, and identifying circumstances surrounding the searches related here. Who, where, and when are frankly altered? What, why, and how are as straightforward as one person's perspective can make them. The dogs are all real. You can hold up a biscuit and call them by name. Chapter 1. Gone. In the long light of early morning, Hunter circles what remains of a burned house, his nose low and brow furrowed. The night's thick air has begun to lift, and the German Shepherd's movement catches the emerging sun. He is a shining thing against the black of scorched brick, burned timber, and a nearby tree charred, leafless. Hunter inspects the tree, half fallen, tilting south away from where the fire was, its birds long gone. Quiet here. I can hear his footpads in the wizened grass, the occasional scrape of his nails across debris. The dog moves along the rubble in his characteristic half-crouch, intense and communicative, while his handler, Max, watches. Hunter rounds the house twice, crosses cautiously through a clear space in the burned pile, and returns to Max with a huff of finality. Nothing, he seems to say. Hunter is not young. There are little flecks of gray about his dark eyes and muzzle, and his body has begun to fail his willing heart. But he knows his job, and he is a proud boy doing it. He leans into his handler and huffs again. Max rubs his ears and turns away. She's not in the house, I murmur into the radio, where a colleague and a sheriff's deputy wait for word from us. Let's go, says Max to Hunter. We move on. Our tracks dark across the ash, Hunter leading us forward into a field that lies behind the house. Here we have to work a little harder across the uneven terrain. Max, a career firefighter used to unstable spaces, manages the unseen critter holes and slick grass better than I do. Hunter cleaves an easy path. Our passage disturbs the field mice, which move in such a body the ground itself appears to shiver. Wide sweeps across the field, back and forth across the wind. Hunter and Max and I, the assistant in trail, continuing to search for some sign of the missing girl. Hunter is an experienced search dog with years of disaster work and many single-victim searches behind him. He moves confidently but not heedlessly, and at the base of a low ridge crowned by a stand of trees, he pauses, head up a long moment, mouth open. His panting stops. Max stops, watches. I stand where I last stepped. And then Hunter is off, scrambling up the ridge with us behind him, crashing through the trees. We hear a surprised shout and scuffling, and when we get to where he is, we see two men stumble away from the dog. One is yelping a little, has barked his shin on a battered dinette chair that he's tripped over. The other hauls him forward by the elbow, and they disappear into the surrounding brush. A third man has more difficulty. He is elderly and not as fast. He has been lying on a bare set of box springs set flat beneath the canopy of trees, and when he rises, the worn cloth of his trousers catches on the coils. We hear rending fabric as he jerks free. He runs in a different direction from the other two. Not their companion, I think. And a few yards away, he stops and turns to peek through the scrub at us, as though aware the dog is not fierce and we aren't in pursuit. Our search has disturbed a small tent city, and as we work our way through the reclaimed box springs and three-legged coffee tables and mouse-eaten recliners that have become a sort of home for its inhabitants, the third man watches our progress from the edge of the brush. This is a well-lived space.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.